Despite tablets and smartphones taking over the majority of portable gaming, the release of next-gen handheld consoles is far from over. The Nintendo Switch, Panic Playdate, and Analogue Pocket all offer unique options. But which device stands out above the rest? We have your definitive answer, and the result may not be what you think. Before you decide what form of entertainment will help fill the void of long car rides, trips to the bathroom, or just lounging around, let's put these handheld devices together in the ultimate battle. Console overviews. The squinting, the craned necks, devices a few inches from their face. The pure signs of a handheld gamer. And no matter what they tell you, screen size does matter. So let's start off with a screen size comparison. First, the Switch. If you're rocking the OG version, then the portable screen measures 6.2 inches. The Switch Lite, a downgrade to 5.5 inches, but both screens do have a 1280 by 720 resolution. As for the Analogue Pocket, well, it's all in the name. The retro-inspired gaming device is supposed to go into your pocket and features a 3.5 inch screen with a pretty impressive 1600 by 1440 resolution and 615 PPI. That's like carrying an HD television around in your pocket. For comparison, the original Game Boy had a max resolution of 160 by 144 pixels. Yeah, we didn't know what we were missing back in the day. The Playdate carries the honor of having the smallest screen at 2.7 inches and has a resolution of 400 by 240 pixels. But one thing that makes the Playdate stand out are the black and white graphics. Lines are solid and there are no motion blurs, creating some pretty striking images. To help make up for the small screens, each portable device pretty much pukes up neon colors with a vivid green for the Playdate, and you can see the Switch Lite a mile away with yellow, gray, and turquoise options. The Analogue Pocket keeps things simple with traditional black and white color schemes. TV connections. All three of the consoles are definitely intended for on-the-go gaming, but sometimes you just want to play on a bigger screen. That's why the Game Boy adapter was released for past consoles like the N64 and GameCube. The original Switch docks to a TV and also acts as the charging base, but it's very different with the Switch Lite. The Lite is intended to be a portable-only gaming solution, meaning there's no option to connect it to a TV. Unless you physically open up the console and know some pretty good hacking tricks. The Playdate's engineers wanted to design a gaming device which would be different from the phone and TV gaming we're used to, pretty much nixing any TV involvement from the get-go. The Playdate is literally a date for your hands. They don't want the TV involved. And this leaves us with the Analogue Pocket. At some point after the launch of the console, the Analogue Pocket will release a HDMI docking bay. The bay not only charges the pocket, but allows gameplay on a television. The Bluetooth connection built into the pocket gives players access to any type of wireless controller, while they recommend one of the 8-bit do wireless options. With the screen resolution and docking options, the Analogue Pocket is pretty much taking the lead so far. Games. Playdate is really setting themselves up to be a niche gaming console. You won't find popular characters like Sonic the Hedgehog, licensed movie properties, or anything found on other consoles. So what does the Playdate have? 12 original games all wrapped up into a single season. And those games? Completely free. But what are the games? Well, Playdate refuses to tell us. The game releases are all going to be a surprise. You won't know the release date, the type of game, or the content. 12 in total randomly downloaded to the device using a Wi-Fi connection. The only game the Playdate has revealed is entitled Krankin's Time Travel Adventure. In the game, you control a robot as he tries to arrive on time for a special date. And a whole lot of obstacles get in his way. The action puzzle game shows off the quirky nature and appeal of the console. With the Switch, you get what you always can expect with the console, a whole lot of Mario. Newer Mario games include Super Mario Odyssey, Super Smash Bros. Ultimate, Super Mario Party, and Luigi's Mansion 3. The Switch really has the major advantage when it comes to game access, because players can purchase physical game cards along with thousands of other games found in the Switch store. Game selection definitely goes to the Switch in this round. Retro games. You may be wondering why we didn't mention any of the Analogue Pocket's original games. Well, it's because there aren't any. Dun dun dun! Okay, yeah, that was a little overdramatic. The console's focused on one thing, retro gaming. But that doesn't mean you should start rushing to download ROMs. The main highlight of the Analogue Pocket is the ability to play old Game Boy cartridges. At launch, the portable console will feature the ability to play Game Boy, Game Boy Color, and Game Boy Advance games. The high-resolution screen and backlight will make the games look better than they ever have, and there is a library of nearly 3,000 games you can purchase from. Thanks to resellers on eBay and the expanded retro gaming market from GameStop, you can easily purchase cartridges you are looking for. Future releases of adapters will open up the device for Game Gear and Nat Geo Color cartridges, among others. The Pocket isn't the only console touting its retro gaming aspect. The Nintendo eShop is full of classic games available on the Switch, but the Nintendo Online subscription truly opens up a huge library of gaming options. The NES Classic Games includes all the original Mario titles, and Nintendo has also begun releasing SNES games to anyone with a Nintendo Online. It's a toss-up here, but the instant access to the NES and SNES retro libraries with multiplayer options gives the Switch the slight edge. Battery life. A portable console is only as good as the batteries it uses. Thankfully, none of these devices rely on the dreaded AA batteries and constant trips to the store to get more. They all feature built-in batteries, with the ability to expand your battery life with the use of a charging bank. The Playdate has not released the full specs of battery power, but the black and white screen helps save a lot of juice while you play. The USB-C port allows traditional charging along with USB power banks. The same applies to the Analogue Pocket, with no specs on the average battery length. The Switch has been released for a bit now, giving us some reliable estimates on the battery life. The Switch Lite can run on an average of 3 to 7 hours depending on what's actually being played. The original Switch would average 2.5 to 6 hours. Seriously though, no time is long enough when you're knee-deep in a great gaming marathon. In the case of the battery battle, we're inclined to give the win to the Playdate thanks to the black and white screen, but without any true stats, the Switch kind of wins by default. But with power banks, charging stations nearly everywhere, and multiple battery grip options, does anyone really run out of battery life anymore? The controls. Okay, we know you've been checking out these pics of the Playdate and been wondering what the heck that crank does on the side. Our first thought? A manual charging device similar to those infomercial flashlights and radios. Well, we couldn't be further from the truth. Living in a touchscreen culture where everything feels tapped out, shout out to Simpsons, the gaming company Panic aimed to create a design that featured a different way to play. The crank. The crank moves forwards and backwards and will work in a variety of different ways. Of course, without the full library of games, we don't know all of those ways, but the preview of Crankin's Time Travel Adventure gives us a pretty good glimpse. Crank the thing forward and the robot walks ahead. Move it backwards and he walks on back. Pretty simple, right? The Playdate also features the basic D-pad with an A and B input button option. And considering the focus on retro cartridge gaming, the Analogue Pocket isn't trying to reinvent the wheel. There's a D-pad and 4 input buttons, along with 2 triggers on the backside. Custom button mapping is available for any game, allowing you to have the comfort of setting up your own playing options. The Switch Lite feels a lot like the 3DS with the controllers built right into the console. As we all pretty much know by now, the original Switch features removable Joy-Con controllers, making multiplayer access a lot easier. The crank is certainly innovative, but we need to see more game demos to see if it's truly sustainable or just really gimmicky. The Analogue Pocket earns points for sticking with tradition while offering extra upgrades. The Switch Lite's controls are nothing special, but the Joy-Con wins as one of Nintendo's best controllers for the diversity and multiple uses. Add-ons. We already mentioned the add-on dock for the Analogue Pocket. But the cartridge add-on will make the Pocket one of the most diverse portable gaming systems. You could easily hop from a Sonic the Hedgehog Game Gear exclusive to Pokemon Blue in a matter of moments. The add-on adapters will feel like a must-own part of the package. The Switch Lite doesn't offer much for add-ons, but anyone with the regular Nintendo Switch does have a lot of options. The Switch Ring Fit Adventure allows gamers to run, jump, and play all types of interactive games. The Nintendo Labo gives gamers the chance to make all types of cardboard add-ons and interactive games. The whole add-on category is really unfair when comparing portable consoles, because these are highlights when the Switch is on its base, but either way, the Switch is the clear-cut winner in the category. As for the Playdate, no extras or add-ons have been announced yet. Online play / multiplayer. Portable gaming really hasn't had a history of multiplayer options. This is one of the biggest limits with the Playdate and Pocket. If there's one thing the Playdate has going for it, it's the release of new games. During the first season, everyone with a Playdate will get the new games on the same release date. This helps build a natural community where gamers can enjoy and experience the new games at the same time. The Pocket's naturally limited to the games available, and a lot of the original Game Boy games were single player. The one bonus? An included Game Boy Link input so you could physically link two of the Analogue Pockets together and enjoy original multiplayer games. And then there's the Switch. Online gaming, multiple Joy-Cons, and multiplayer hits like Super Smash Bros. All make it an essential multiplayer gaming option. Nintendo Online is only $20 a year, giving gamers access to all types of games including Minecraft, Overwatch, and free-to-play titles like Fortnite. Yeah, we don't really have to state it out loud, but we will anyway. If you're looking for multiplayer options, the Switch is definitely the way to go. The extras. Portable consoles have always had a big focus on purely gaming, but there are plenty of extras to enjoy as well. The Switch gives gamers access to video channels like Hulu and YouTube. It's a little more limited than home-based consoles like the PS4 and Xbox One, but you still have some entertainment options with a Wi-Fi connection. The Analogue Pocket doesn't have video streaming services, but the device does go deep into the world of music development. When you're not playing one of the classic game cartridges, you have the ability to mix all types of music. The advanced music tools on the Pocket will help you create and publish advanced music tracks. Known as Nano Loop, you can play around with the music for hours, creating all types of interesting tracks and sounds. The Playdate is strictly games. The main focus is on the 12 games and delivering a truly unique gaming experience. So if you're looking for extras, that's what you whip your phone out for. Our verdict? The video streaming on the Switch is a nice touch, but we're really intrigued on how the Nano Loop music will work on the Pocket. Let's call it a tie. The prices. Okay, we've learned a ton about the portable consoles, but how much money are these bad boys gonna take from our wallets? Let's start with the most expensive, the standard Switch. The Switch's retail price is $300 and is something that doesn't look like it's budging anytime soon. The Switch Lite is the more affordable option, priced at $199, but with less features. The cheapest of the pack is the Playdate at $149. That price does include the whole Season 1 bundle of 12 games, so there's a little extra value in the initial price. The Analogue Pocket has a set price at $199, the same as the Switch Lite. The screen quality really helps justify the price, but it's hard to predict how much extra you'll be spending on game cartridges. If you saved your Game Boy games from over the years, then you're good to go. But if not, start shopping online and at flea markets to save a little dough. There's no price info for the TV docks or cartridge adapters quite yet, but both are definitely worth the investment. The Nintendo Switch accessories can add a lot of extra spending, including the expensive costs of Joy-Con controllers. Either way, the Switch is the most value for the money, but the quality and presentation of the Analogue Pocket makes it worth $200. Okay, the verdict is in. We've broken everything down. There's really no competing with the Nintendo Switch, but the Analogue Pocket can definitely give the handheld market a run for its money. And now it's your turn. What console do you think is the best? What one do you want to buy when they're all on the market in 2020? Well, let us know in the comments and stick around the gamer for more great video game content. We're releasing new videos every couple of days. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to subscribe to stay up to date with the channel.